This is a video showing how to do the calibration within the materials testing machine. The easiest way to start this calibration process is to navigate to the web page for the materials testing machine. On that site, you're going to find this lab compliance calibration tutorial, which will walk you through this process that I'm going to show in this video. So I've previously connected my materials testing machine to a port on my 850. Of course, this can be done through any passport type interface, including the AirLink. Next, to go through the calibration, I can click on the calibration button, and it's going to prompt me for the compliance calibration. I'll click on Next. In this case, I'm going to create a new calibration. Once you've created the new calibration, then we can go back in and manage the existing calibrations to place that calibration actually on the instrument. The advantage of this is that you can then import that calibration from the instrument into any workbook that you're going to use with that instrument in the future. So we're going to continue with the creation of the new calibration, and we'll click on Next. The diagram here shows the installation of the calibration fixture within the load cell. Please make sure that you have at least 4 threads mounted within the load cell on the bottom. This will make sure that there is sufficient material to take the forces that we're going to exert on the item. Also, once we've installed the bottom here, we're going to then lower the crosshead here on top of the calibration fixture. Once this has been lowered down, there's a knurled knob that will go on the top. Please make sure that once you've lowered the crosshead, that knurled knob will turn 4 times while engaging these threads without having significant resistance, to make sure that it's not preloading the sample, but also to make sure that we have at least 4 of these threads engaged with the knurled cap. We'll go ahead and click on Next. Now we're going to collect a run of sample data. So once I click on the record button, it is monitoring the both load cell and the optical encoders on the drive screws. I'm going to turn this clockwise to put a preload on my sample. Right now, there's no load on my sample, as you can see on the lower right-hand side, and I'm going to slowly advance this. Because of the stiffness of the calibration fixture, it's possible to generate very large forces very quickly with this. So you can see that I have a very small load of 3 newtons here, and I'm actually going to stop my run here. The reason for that is so that I don't have this portion of my graph where there was no load on the sample. I'm now going to press record again. It resets the load cell to 0 newtons, even though I have a residual force of 2 newtons. Within the grand scheme of things, this is a very small load, so that small offset is not going to matter a whole bunch. Okay, we're going to go ahead and start data collection again. We see the polynomial curve fit that's being applied to this that's going to help us with our calibration. I'm going to slowly tighten this again. And you can see that I'm not getting much displacement here, or I'm not getting much increase in load here. So I am going to continue advancing this until I can start to see that I'm starting to get a little bit more force. And again, I'll go ahead and hit stop again and hit record. The reason for this is I want to make sure that I'm getting a clean curve here. And you can see I'm getting a fairly consistent increase in force here. So I'm going to actually back this off to a very low level of force here and stop data collection. We'll start data collection again and then load it up. We're going to load it up to about 100 newtons, or actually, 200 newtons, and then unload it again. So you can see that we've got a pretty close association for the loading and unloading curves. However, I do want to make sure that we're getting rid of any hysteresis loop that's in there that you can see as we expand it out for the auto scale. We still have a little bit of an open loop here. So I'm going to load the sample again and to make sure that it's going to load pretty much on the same line here. And we'll repeat this process a couple different times. What this does is make sure that the sample is properly seated and any irregularities in the threads are flattened out. So we can see that when we advance and reverse the loading of the sample, we're traveling pretty much along the same curves here. And again, we'll repeat this process a couple times. Once we're satisfied that we're traveling pretty much the same line here, we'll go ahead and unload this to about 10 newtons. And we'll go ahead and hit stop. To help with the precise loading of this, what I will do is I'll place one of my hands actually on the axle. And then rather than driving it using the rotating handle, I'll actually use my other hand pretty much about halfway up the arm for the loading handle so that I'm able to more closely control the displacement of the crosshead. But again, because of the stiffness of the sample, can generate very large loads very, very quickly. Okay, I'm now going to hit the record button again, and now we're ready to load this up to the full calibration load that we're going to have. In this case, it's going to be about 7,000 newtons. So this time I'm actually going to apply the force from the full length of the handle, because I'm going to start to get a little bit more resistance from that handle. And we'll go ahead and load it up again here to about 7,000 newtons. And once I've loaded up to 7,000 newtons, I'm going to stop data collection rather than unloading the sample. And that's pretty close. There's going to be a little bit of backlash on this, so go ahead and keep it loaded and click stop. So you can see that we've got a fairly consistent curve here with a really low RMSE value. So then this polynomial looks like it's a good fit. So we can go ahead and click on the next button here. It's going to give the curve fit parameters down here. And it will state that the curve fit was successful. We'll click on next. And then we're going to name the calibration here. It's very useful to note whether this calibration was done in tension and also the load that was given during the loading so that future users will understand whether this was in tension or in compression. And then also, please give the date of calibration so that if it's been a while since the calibration has been done, that will give the future users a chance to evaluate whether they should redo the calibration. And in this case, we'll put today's date and click on finish. Okay, so this calibration is now part of this file. So what we'd like to do now is we're going to load this into the actual instrument itself. So it takes us back to the beginning of the calibration menu, and I'll click on Next. Now, instead of creating a new calibration, we're going to go down to Manage Existing Calibration and click on Next. So this will allow us to save the calibration onto the instrument itself. So if I click on, rather than renaming this, we're going to click on Save Calibration and Sensor, and then click on Next. So we're going to have a listing of the different calibrations here that are within a device. In this case, I have two empty slots here. Then click on one of the empty calibration slots, and I'll click on Finish. So now we can go back in and confirm that we have the calibration. So we now have the option to import calibration from sensor. This is what you would likely do if you're opening up another workbook or creating your own workbook and don't want to have to go through the calibration process again. So if I click on Import Calibration from Sensor, I now have my pull-down menu, and I can select the calibration which I've just loaded into the instrument. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact teacher support at support@pasco.com if you'd like additional assistance with your materials testing machine.